Thank you for joining me for another episode of Awaken and Power TV. I'm your host, Ethan Fox. Today I'm joined by Dr. Eric Pearl. We start by talking about his life journey and some of the very fascinating stories of events that happened along the way to his discovery of reconnective healing. We talk further about some of the research that's been done into DNA experiments using reconnective healing and a variety of other things, some of the different kinds of healing experiences. And then we also talk about the awakening of consciousness that's happening globally and what he has observed in his work as well in that area. Dr. Eric Pearl will be joining us at our Awakened Empowered Expo this November 4th, 5th, and 6th in downtown Detroit, along with a lot of other incredible presenters, some of whom will be on the show in the next several weeks, including George Lamoureux speaking about Chinese herbalism, Dr. Robert Schock about ancient civilizations, Michaela Sheldon, who is on the show a lot, and she'll be doing a two-hour event there and also channeling, as well as doing a private workshop for a small group of people. So those are some amazing events you don't want to miss, including a free exhibitor area and a VIP afterglow if you'd like to hang out with some of the presenters and the expo staff for a little while Saturday night. So do join us. You can find out more information and buy tickets at awakenempoweredexpo.com or AAEEXPO.com. So without any further delay, though, today I'd like to bring on Dr. Eric Pearl. Hi, Dr. Pearl. Welcome to Awaken and Power TV. It's a pleasure to have you on my show and to finally meet you. And we're going to have the opportunity to meet in person this November at our Awaken and Power Expo in Detroit, which I'm very excited to see you there. And you're calling from in from LA today, right?
In from Los Angeles, just arrived from Houston, giving our last U.S. training program of the year in reconnective healing, and giving our first pilot program in reconnective healing for pets. So I had a very interesting 10 or 12 days in hot, humid Austin, Texas. But I'm glad to be here back in LA. And I'm very excited to be on your show, and I'm very excited to be at the expo coming up in Detroit, because who can think of Detroit without thinking of the Motor City, the music? I grew up in South Jersey and Philadelphia, so the Philly-Detroit sound of music is what I was raised with, and I love that.
Yeah, I'd like to actually mention the working on pets. I'd like to speak about that a little bit later. But to start, I want to, for those of our guests, and I'm sure a lot of our viewers are familiar with your work, but quite a few probably are not. So if you can give us a little bit of history and your educational background, basically what the journey was like for you to go from, you know, from where you were before to the work that you're doing now.
Well, you know, life is always a journey, as we discover, and interesting in different ways. Mine was that I went through school somehow. Somehow, because I was never really what you would call a student. I didn't focus, I didn't study, and although my mother never liked me saying this, I didn't really enjoy reading. Somehow or other, I gleaned and absorbed enough from putting in my time in the classroom to make it through school. And when I graduated high school, I didn't know where to go or what to do. And I remember going down to the guidance counselor, which is where everyone would go when they were getting ready to graduate high school, to get some career direction. And they were handing us sheets of paper, just a sheet of paper, like an 8x10 or 8x11 sheet of paper, with a list of possible careers. And there I saw it. My entire life's possibility of careers was supposedly on that list, on that sheet of paper. And I read the list, and I couldn't find myself anywhere on it. So my parents told me that if I wanted to take a year off from school before I went to college, because I figured I should go to undergraduate school anyway, everyone went to college, I could take that year off. Now, that would sound very exciting to a lot of people, but I had a little bit of wisdom within me, and I said I'd better not, because I so disliked school that I was afraid if I took a year off, I wouldn't be able to talk myself into going back. So I went to undergraduate school for liberal arts education. I changed majors several times. Went from pre-law and to modern dance into exploring possibly a career in religion, into the concept of art. I just changed my mind, you know, pretty much about as often as someone changes their clothes. But somewhere, several years into it, I was introduced to a doctor of chiropractic who introduced me to a concept, who explained that the body's designed perfectly. Doesn't need anything added to it. It just doesn't need any interference. And showed me diagrams and schematics about how our brain changes shape and becomes the brain stem and becomes the spinal cord. And from in between the bones of the vertebra and the spine, the nerve roots travel throughout our bodies and they attach to all of our organs and the various cells in our bodies. And that our bodies have a given lifespan. Pretty much, let's say our cells have given lifespans. So your skin cells might be new every 30 days and your liver cells every 6 weeks, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And what we know today through quantum physics is that our bodies are approximately 98% brand new every given year. They look pretty much similar, but they're brand new. It's sort of as if you live in a brick house and every day you walk outside of that brick house, you remove a few old bricks, you replace them with a few new bricks, and then you go to work. And the next morning you get up, you remove a few more old ones, you replace them with a few more new ones, and you repeat that pattern moving around the house. By the end of the year, you have a new house, except it looks pretty much the same. That's the way our bodies function. As long as the brain is unimpeded sending its communication to the cells in our bodies, our cells replace themselves when their lifespan is up with new healthy cells. But when there's an interference, when something is out of position in the spine, there's an interference with that message getting through. Then when the old cell dies, the new cell that comes to replace it may be less than healthy. So say, for example, the nerve to your liver, the nerve impulse is being interfered with. So your liver cells start replacing themselves less than 100%. Pretty soon you have a liver that's not able to do its job fully. So it sends incomplete toxins, because our liver deals with our toxins, to the kidneys. Your kidneys get overworked, so they excrete the toxins in the bloodstream. The bloodstream doesn't know what to do with them, so they excrete the toxins out the skin. We don't know what to do with that when we see it on our skin, so we go to a dermatologist who gives us antibiotics. The antibiotics further stresses the liver, and we stay on a cycle of antibiotics and bad skin for a lengthy period of time. What chiropractic does is it finds the interference with the nerve communication to the liver. It removes the interference. The liver cells start replacing themselves healthy. The kidney deals with what it's supposed to deal. There's no more toxins in the bloodstream. It's not coming out through the skin. And everyone looks good and feels good and is healthy again. And I thought, this makes perfect sense. So I decided to go to school for chiropractic. I go to school the first day. It's a huge class and everyone is being asked why they're there. This one's there because they had this healing, and this one's there because they were injured in a plane crash and couldn't walk, and now they can. And everyone's having these dramatic healings, and they get to me, and they ask me why I'm there. And I hadn't even been to a chiropractor. All I could say was, well, it sounded good. I did see it work very consistently, and it was beautiful. I saw it work in the philosophy and the consciousness of chiropractic, which unfortunately today, maybe only about 20% of chiropractors understand. And unfortunately, because of that, the consciousness of removing an interference, getting out of the way and allowing the body to heal itself was beaten out of the majority of students in school because they were trying to become more pseudo-medical at that time. And so we became very symptom-focused and diagnosis-oriented and how do you get rid of this problem and how do you get rid of that problem. And by the time I opened my practice, about 4 years later, I was doing symptom-oriented chiropractic. And I did that for about 9 years, the first 9 years of my practice, until someone reintroduced me to the philosophy and the principle of chiropractic again. And as I recognized the truth in it, I put all my physical therapy away, and I just looked to find an interference, remove it, get out of the way, and my patients started to have healings at consistently higher levels. I did that for the next 3 years until my 12th year in practice. The consciousness within me changed, the awareness changed, and then you could say part of the next step in the reward I received was that one night a few strange things happened. I was awakened in the middle of the night by a very bright light. I opened my eyes to see what it was, and it wasn't anything seemingly spiritual or metaphysical. It was just the lamp next to my bed, for some reason, had managed to turn itself on. Now, I had had that lamp for a good 10 years. It hadn't selected any other propitious occasion to self-ignite, but there it was. And I thought maybe it was an electrical short, except shorts usually turn things off, and this turned on. But the next thing that caught my notice was that my bedroom door was open, and it was closed when I went to sleep. So now I wondered, was someone in my house? This is not a comfortable feeling to wake up to, so I got a knife and an old can of pepper spray from a self-defense course I must have taken 8 or 10 years earlier, which was probably dried out and empty, but I thought it made me look intimidating, and my Doberman pinscher, and we went hunting through the house and couldn't find anyone, and I finally decided it was my imagination, so I went back to my bed to go to sleep. I went to turn the lamp off next to my bed. You know that little round knob that's on about 90% of every lamp in the United States? Well, everything for me, I'm a clicker and a shutter and a locker. My windows are locked. My door is shut. My toothpaste cap is on. And my lamp is clicked on and clicked off. The knob on the lamp was rotated enough to have turned the lamp on, but not clicked into place. And I thought, that's not me. And I don't know what's going on, but I guess it's time to go to bed or I'll be a wreck for my patients the next day. So I went to sleep. That Monday, I went into my office. 7 of my patients, independently of one another, started reporting unusual things. See, what I would do was I would have my patient lie down on the table, the massage or the adjusting table, chiropractic table. I would adjust their spine. I would then tell them to close their eyes and relax for 30 seconds or a minute or so. And then, so everything would settle into place, and then I'd let them open their eyes and leave. 7 of my patients, when they opened their eyes from that, all without knowing anyone else had said it, told me that it felt as if someone had come into the room. They asked me who walked into the room. I said, no one. They said, the person who stood by the door. I said, no one stood there. They said, I heard them come in. I said, no one came in. They said, I felt them here. I said, no one was here. This went on and on and on. In between them, other patients were telling me that they felt multiple sets of hands resting on them in different places in a very comforting way when I hadn't been touching them at all. As these discussions went on, I started feeling interesting sensations in my hands. As I would hold my hands near them or move my hands near them, their bodies would go into involuntary movements, their fingers would move, their arms and legs would move, their eyes would rapidly dart back and forth. When they opened their eyes, they started to tell me that they were seeing colors they'd never seen, smelling flowers they'd never smelled. And they started demonstrating healings, real healings. Some of them were getting up out of wheelchairs. Others were telling me that they could see colors when they had been colorblind as far back as they recall. Others were seeing again when they had difficulty seeing, hearing again. Patients started calling me the next day, telling me they went into the hospital to have a planned surgery and what was supposed to be removed from them was no longer there and they were sent home without the surgery. Parents of some of my younger patients were calling me, asking me what had happened because their children who had cerebral palsy were able to walk and run and play and speak normally. doctors started calling me saying some of the patients who had seen me, maybe the children who had epilepsy, weren't having seizures any longer, weren't needing their medications. Everyone started asking me what I had done. It. The truth is, who knew? So I said, well, I didn't do anything and don't tell anybody. And of course, the more you say that, the more everyone starts saying, I want the same thing. And they started coming in asking for the same thing. And soon people started asking me to teach this. And I said, how in the world do you teach this? I'm standing there, really, I'm just waving my hands in the air. I said, you go outside, wave your hands in the air, tell me what your neighbors say about you. But the more people asked me to teach this, and the more I really didn't think that I could, the more I started hearing back from my patients that when they drove home from my office, they drove up in front of their house, their automatic garage door started to open and close by itself, their televisions were turning on and off, their lamps were turning off and on, they were feeling sensations in their hands, they would hold their hands near a relative or someone in the family, and the uncle could walk again after the stroke, and the grandmother was able to do something else that she couldn't do before when she had a problem, and the drop foot went away, and all these healings started taking place. And that's when I began to recognize that once we interact with what science today calls the reconnective healing frequencies, not only does something change within us that allows us to return to our more optimal state of health and balance, but once we learn how to become intimately familiar with it and work with it, we can learn how to facilitate healings for others as well.
So tell me, that's a very fascinating story that you've had. Now, did you know as a child that you had any sort of inclination or interest in healing or any sort of spiritual ability? I find that's... What's that?
You said, you're good. You came right back to that one, didn't you? You weren't going to let me skip over that. You know, things happen. When I wrote the book, when I wrote The Reconnection, Hay House, my publisher, came to me and asked me to write it. And I told them, I said, you know, as I may have mentioned earlier, I was never really much of a student. I didn't read a lot. I didn't write a lot. My mother got called into school when I was little all the time because I didn't do my homework. So writing a book could be a bit of a challenge. I wouldn't even know how to begin. And they said, here's what we want you to do. We want you to take the first third of the book, write about how you discovered reconnective healing and your early life and what indicators you may have had. Take the second portion of the book and talk about the science as you understand it and what reconnective healing is, the philosophy, the art of it. Take the third portion of it and make it a basic how-to so beginners can begin to learn how to work with reconnective healing. It won't make them professionals, but they can begin to feel it and experiment with it. So I thought, well, part two and part three make sense. Who really cares about me in my early life? But they wanted it. So then I had to think about it, and I thought, I don't know. If we think about our early lives, I mean, really, it's our lives. We have nothing to compare it to. So how do we know what's different? How do we know what's special? How do we know what's unique? I came up with a couple of things. I knew, for example, that when I was, I don't know how old, but probably single-digit age, my grandfather gave me a box of old watches. He had saved all of his watches. He would take them to the watch repair place again and again and again until they couldn't fix them any longer. And then instead of throwing them away, he kept them in a box. He brought me the box of watches. He thought I might find these interesting toys, you know, for a young child. Now, you know how some people can't wear the old-fashioned wind-up watch. They put it on something they claim is in their magnetic field that causes watches to stop. And a lot of people have that problem. The opposite thing happened with me. I could take those broken watches and hold them, and they would just start ticking again and working again. Soon, my friend's parents started giving them their old watches to bring to me to hold and to fix. So, you know, I could say that was different. It didn't strike me as that unusual at a time when I was that age, but I didn't know what to compare it to. I have other stories, but really, they're just points in time, which becomes a problem, to use that analogy already, because let's face it, what we know as time today is really, we understand through unified field quantum physics that time is ultimately an illusion anyway, but at that point in, we'll call it time. You don't really know when something begins. You only know when you notice it. If you're diagnosed with a problem, people say, when did it start? You tell them when you were diagnosed, but who the hell knows when it started? My life began similarly and differently than many people's. We're all born. We all come through the process, I believe, of a consciousness that has existed in multidimensional time-space, space-time. And then we maybe choose to incarnate for a journey on Earth. My introduction to being born, my Earth journey, was a little different than some people's because my mother died giving birth to me. She was lying in the delivery room, lying on the table in the delivery room. She heard and felt loud motors starting at her feet and then shutting off, and then moving to her ankles and then shutting off, moving to her knees and then shutting off. Very disturbing in the delivery room itself. And she tried to get the doctor's attention, but she couldn't. She felt it moving up towards her heart. She somehow knew that if it got to her heart and shut off, that she would die. And she didn't want to die. She was giving birth to her first child. And she tried to get everyone's attention and tried and couldn't. It shut off at her heart. And the next thing she knew, she felt herself leaving her body. Leaving her body, drifting upwards somewhere. She passed through what she considered the first level or layer of beings, those who had left the physical body, those we might say had died or transitioned. And she found that that first level, pretty much still here, close to being on Earth, were those people who felt that their job was not yet complete here. They felt the need to hang or stay or take care of something or complete something. I just didn't realize that they had yet died. And she drifted through a second level she doesn't recall. She drifted through a third level, which was the only one that felt uncomfortable for her, because that was the level of people who had done the one thing. It became clear that was an interruption to the overall design of what you might call God's plan or the plan of the universe. Those people had taken their own lives, and she felt that they were temporarily delayed. They existed in a plane that was uncomfortable for them and uncomfortable for us to pass through, but that they would eventually move on. She passed through more, eventually got to an upper level where she felt herself drifting down a lane toward a very bright light. She feels that that was the equivalent of what people say they get as moving through a tunnel. She felt herself drifting down this lane. She saw flowers she had never seen, colors she had never seen. She saw this bright light way ahead, but she didn't want to look at it because it was so bright she was afraid that it would burn her eyes. But then she realized there was nothing physical to burn. She could look at it, and it was beautiful. And as she continued toward that light, she saw people that she recognized, not just from her immediate lifetime, but from many lifetimes. And one of her first understandings is that we cycle and recycle through multiple lifetimes for different lessons and experiences on Earth, what some people might call old souls and new souls. People were welcoming her, encouraging her. There was no language, no words. One look would convey volumes of information. She started becoming imbued with insights. The first insight she was given is that if there is only one regret people who transition human lifetime have, that regret is that those of us who are left behind feel sad, that we mourn them because we don't understand what a beautiful place it is that we all return to. We're actually returning to home, where we come from. It's a very short period of time until we're all together and we meet there again. She understood how ridiculous it is for us to judge people by their appearance. She understood why the earth was round, why the grass was green, why the sky is blue. How we can't blame God for the most seemingly horrible things that people do here on earth or what happens. She understood that there's a reason for everything, and when you are there, everything makes perfect sense. But we are not here on earth to understand everything. We are here to seek the answers, not to have the answers. Our growth comes from the seeking of the answers. And then she found herself presented before that very bright light. And her life was laid out before her. And I know this can sound as if there's an inherent contradiction in it, but she said her life was laid out before her and she knew it was a good life, and yet there was no judgment. And she said, that is not contradictory. It's just that here with our four-dimensional linear-based language, we don't have the words to explain the experience of love or the freedom of judgment that goes on there. We do experience the emotions, the joy and the upsets that we bring to others. That is part of our experience there. And all of her attachment to responsibility was gone. There was an absolute freedom. There was a love. It was such a beautiful space. And then suddenly she found herself being sent back. And for all the struggling she did not to die in the first place, now she didn't want to leave. But she found herself coming back, and she realized that she was programmed to forget all of the insights that she'd been given. And there are many, many, many more insights. I'm just sharing with you the surface. The entire second chapter of the Reconnection of the book is her, she and I working together to write down and explain as much of the insights as we possibly could. She found that she was programmed to forget all of these insights, and she struggled to hold on to these. And this is pretty much what she brought back with her. Now, I will tell you that approximately 5 years ago, she did pass. She looked forward to it. She knew where she was going. And I tell you, after her experience, she no longer feared death, but she did up until then. She shared that experience with me when I was maybe about 5 and my grandmother died and I had questions. And my fear of death vanished. I think when we are exposed to something that vibrates at an unquestionable level of truth, we become forever changed. I look forward to that experience. Now, I don't mean, don't get me wrong, that I want to die soon. I have a lot to do here and I want to be here to do it. But I don't fear that experience. I look forward to that experience as well. Now, did I have an unusual childhood? I don't know. But I definitely had an interesting introduction.
Thank you. That was a very, very interesting story. And I know that in your, when you started having these experiences with discovering reconnective healing, a lot of your patients started channeling. And so obviously you've been exposed to these sorts of things. Have you ever explored working with a channel as far as contemplating what you came here to do or anything relevant that you might not have shared already?
You know, I had a fairly usual standard upbringing with color. It was colorful, a little colorful, less than some people I know, more than others. We had interesting friends, psychologists, archaeologists, fascinating people would come over. I'll tell you the truth, I very much looked forward to coming home from school more than spending time with my friends in school. I enjoyed spending time with my parents' friends who would be at the house. So I experienced different things. Yes, I assume at times we were introduced to someone who may have been a card reader or a palm reader or felt that they were psychic. We experienced those. I didn't chase that. You know, I went to school to become a doctor. I studied. That was what I had planned and intended. I wasn't studying Reiki and Jin Shin and Qigong and energy healing techniques and methods. I think I once took a three-hour presentation. I attended a three-hour presentation in Reiki or something. But I didn't practice it. I didn't plan it. I don't think I consciously, anyway, intended it. So this was a little bit of an unexpected surprise. I started to answer your question, and your question just left my head, so I don't know where to direct it. Can you bring it back to me?
Well, my question is really because you had a very unusual childbirth experience and you've been exposed to a lot of very uninteresting people, and I know that some of your patients also started channeling unexpectedly.
Right.
And so I'm curious if you ever were curious enough to explore your own journey and why you came here, what you came here to do, because you mentioned earlier you have a long life to live because you have a lot of things you want to do. So have you ever sought any guidance as to what that is that you are here to do?
I believe, I know that I'm here to bring the consciousness of reconnective healing onto the planet. It is different in many ways. And I know we will get into that during the interview, but it is, in a nutshell, it is a way for us to access a far more comprehensive way of accessing and facilitating healings for ourselves and others through freeing ourselves from complex techniques and ritual for the sake of ritual and fear-based protections and external healing objects and other approaches, and instead allowing ourselves to regain our internal essence, to honor our internal power and to become the healing itself without needing to do or add anything. But channeling. Here's what happened. About 3 months into the presentation of Reconnective Healing onto the planet, one of my patients, I'm trying to decide how to start the story. There are at least six entrances into every story that you trigger within me. One of my patients, I held my hands near them, and his head jerked back, his eyes rolled back into his head, his mouth opened, his tongue started to move, air began to audibly escape through his mouth. And the air sound condensed itself into, at first, a high-pitched, sort of scratchy, almost squeaky kind of a voice, which then became a rather deep and full voice. And the voice said, "We are here to tell you to continue doing what you were doing. What you are doing is bringing light and information onto the planet." Now, I do want you to know that there seemed very little question that I was standing in the presence of yet another very powerful experience. The voice said a few more things through this patient, but I realized that all my other patients were in other rooms waiting for me. I couldn't stand there forever. And so I said to the voice, "How can I reach you again?" And the voice said, "You may find me in your heart." Well, I'm sorry, I'm a rather type A personality. "You may find me in your heart" is a perfectly good answer for someone else, but not me. I wanted to know how to reach this voice. "So you may find me in your heart," it repeated. Well, I really didn't want that, and I pushed and I pushed and I pushed, and finally said, "You may reach me through this person again." I wasn't going to leave the room until I got an answer with that kind of substance, because I really didn't want to say, "Thank you, oh great and powerful, wonderful voice from the universe for coming to visit me, but right now I have patients, it's not a convenient time. Could you come back at 7 would be better, you know?" So I had to find a way. Voice said, "You can reach me through this patient again." I said, "Thank you very much." And then the voice stopped talking, and I touched the patient lightly to see if I could get him to open his eyes. I said, "Fred," because that was his name. Fred opened his eyes, and he was rather unaware of what had gone on. He sensed that something had happened, but he didn't know exactly what. He didn't know exactly what he had said. So I shared the story with him. But I wondered, was it Fred? What was it? Was it real? Was it a misimagination? Was the patient a little off balance? Was I being given a performance? I mean, I could have thought of lots of different possibilities. I didn't have much question in me 2 days later, because it happened to three other patients. I held my hands near them, their heads jerked, their eyes rolled, their mouth opened, their tongue moved, air came out. It condensed itself into a voice, and the voice said the first two phrases that Fred said, "We are here to tell you to continue doing what you are doing. What you are doing is bringing light and information onto the planet." Then two of those three other patients added, "What you were doing is reconnecting strands." One of them added, "What you're doing is reconnecting strings." Fred came back in later, I believe that week or a few days later, and said, "What you're doing is reconnecting strings." Now, none of these four people knew each other or had ever met. Fred may or may not have had a voice start to come through him before this, but the others did not. A few days later, five other patients did it. Overall, over the next 3 months, 1, 2, 3 months, it started in the beginning of like a week or two into January. So February, March to mid-April, over 50, that's 50, over 50 different patients lost consciousness and spoke six verbatim phrases. I shared with you the first four right now. And we could talk about the potential of what they mean and other things, you know, later on if we go in that direction. But the funny thing is that mid-April, it went from starting in January way up, staying consistent with over 50 different patients, none of whom had a voice come through them before, except, as I said, maybe Fred. And then it came to a quick sputtering stop. It was an experience, an interesting time in my life, watching this happen for many reasons. I remember bumping in to some of my patients who left, and they told me they got scared or they were angry because the voices were coming through them. I said, I don't know what you're angry at me for. The voices were coming through you, but you know, they just, you know, didn't feel comfortable. It was so unusual, so outside of their norm. Many of them came back afterwards, you know, when they got used to it and got word of what was going on with these healings. It was an interesting time for me because I was trying to do my best to come to terms with the enormity of what was going on. For example, go back again in time to when I was give or take 5 years old, 4 or 5 years old. I remember one time telling my mother I had a bad dream. I explained to her I knew I was dreaming, but I couldn't wake up. And she said, the next time you have a bad dream, blink your eyes 3 times real hard, and the third time, open them really hard and hold them open until you wake up, and you'll come out of it. And I want you to know that really works. So for all of you parents out there, honest to God, if your kids have bad dreams, they know it's a dream, you tell them to blink their eyes 3 times, and the third time, hold their eyes wide open until they wake up, and they will. It's great. Well, you know, great to know as a child. You don't think about that later on in life. One day, a few months into the healings that happened and the channelings are going on, I'm calling them channeling. You could say they were speaking in tongues, except the tongue was English. I walk out my front door one morning, getting ready to go in the office. I'm facing my front door. I'm about to set the alarm keypad, and I realize no one can see me. No one can see me. And all I can do is think about what's going on. And I asked myself, I said, what if this whole thing is my imagination? What if I was in a car accident or something, ended up in a coma? I could be in a coma right now. Maybe I've been in a coma in the hospital for the past 3 months. I'm imagining this whole thing. So as I was facing the front door and no one from the street could see me, I blinked my eyes 3 times, and the third time I held them wide open, and I did not wake up. So if this is a dream, welcome to it, because you're now in it with me. And this was part of me exploring, is this real? And people say to me interesting things, including, thank you for being so brave as to bringing this work forward. And that's a very nice thing to say. Except I can't take credit. I can't take credit for being brave. So it wasn't brave. People who are brave are people who do what they were afraid to do. We grow from walking through our fears. That's where our growth comes from. It's like we don't grow from the answers, we grow from seeking the answers. I was never afraid of this. Interestingly enough, I was never afraid of it. I knew I was standing in the presence of something huge, and I had a choice. I could view it from fear. I could view it from wonder and awe. And it's a very similar feel to the two. As a matter of fact, one time I was giving a presentation in the north of Israel in a city called Svat, which is the cradle of Kabbalah. And I was sharing the stage with the head Kabbalah rabbi there. And we gave a presentation and we had, you know, dialogue back and forth in front of the audience. And I shared with him a question I had had on my mind for many years. There's an expression used often in, at least in American Christianity, God-fearing. People say, I'm a God-fearing Christian. I said, that phrase never made sense to me. Why would God want you to be in fear? And I received a rather enlightening explanation. We look at words and we view them either on their base surface level, or we allow them to come to a higher, more evolved level. The original word in Hebrew was nora. Nora means, in a sense, terrible. It's a fear word. But at its highest level, instead of meaning fear, it means awe, wonder in the presence of something huge. And they do have a similar feeling before we decide where to take what we don't know, the unknown, and to classify it as fear, which we have a tendency to do, fear of the unknown. Or we can look at it as an invitation to step into something wonderful and awesome. And I simply chose to step forward. I didn't really experience fear on any level outside of initially wondering whether someone might be in my house, turning on my light and opening my bedroom door. That was my only real moment of it. I believe that we are continually, depending on which word you choose, there is a slight difference in meaning, being shown our life purpose, being given an opportunity to live our life purpose. Now, I know that in the more conscious, spiritual, metaphysical world, lucky is not a respected word because we want to replace the concept of luck with synchronicity, but it just doesn't work in what I'm about to say. I believe that we are lucky or fortunate if we allow ourselves to recognize our life purpose. But I believe that we are truly fortunate where we not only allow ourselves to recognize it, but we choose to step into it and live it. I have chosen to live what I know is my life purpose. And I'm very thankful for that. Many people go through their life path doing things that don't allow their heart to sing. Taking a job because it pays this much money per hour. Going to work doing the same thing day in and day out that they don't love. Maybe it's because they don't love it. Maybe it's because they haven't allowed themselves to recognize the love that they really do have for it. And with a different perspective, they could experience that. Maybe it's their life path at one level, and maybe there's a more evolved life path. I believe that part of our life course is to bring a consciousness to the world. For me, it's around reconnective healing. It's that we can become more. We can become the healings instead of having to do the healing. Just like when you take a lit candle and use it to light another candle, to light another candle, to light another candle, you don't see that flame doing a technique. You don't see it doing anything. You don't see it calling on anything external, such as a crystal or a healing toy. You don't see it having to protect itself. You don't see the flame getting weak. The flame glows more brightly. It even gives off a sound. The sound of inspiration, because it simply stands in its own truth, its own integrity, its own essence and wonder and splendor. And by doing so, its presence simply inspires the next flame to ignite, and the next flame to ignite, and the next flame to ignite. And we can learn to do that. And if we choose to live our own life course, then part of the light that we share with people is to inspire their own healing. Reconnective healing is not just about regaining the use of an arm or a leg or a liver or a kidney or vision or hearing. It encompasses all of that, embodies all of that. It embodies healing's physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual. And we hear those words and we don't think any longer because we've heard those words so repetitively that our mind shuts off at it. But it throws us onto our life course more rapidly than we ever would have thought. It evolves our love relationships, our career paths. Reconnect feeling is life progress. It's human evolution. It's life progress. And we teach it at two different levels. Just basically what we call level one and level two. The level one of the Reconnective Healing Training Program allows you to focus basically on self-healing and, you know, your own coming into a better state of balance and health overall. And sure, it gives you the beginning of the gifts to start to help your immediate circle of friends and family. But level two, the foundational program, allows you the opportunity to become a professional Reconnective Healing practitioner, which doesn't mean you have to do it professionally, but isn't it nice to know the skill at that level? But what I'm trying to get to, the point I'm trying to get to with this is, it gives us the opportunity of saying, maybe wherever I have been on my life path and my career path has been absolutely perfect just for this moment to recognize that there's more. But maybe I want to do something that does make my heart sing. Maybe I want to get up every morning and know that what I will be doing will be touching as many people with the light and love of healing as possible as the way that I contribute to the universe and the way I receive from the universe. Maybe becoming a healthcare practitioner at the level of Reconnective Healing so that I can spend my life inspiring healing and balance and evolution within everyone with whom I interact. When you drop a pebble into a pond, there's a ripple, and then you see three, and then you see six. And maybe you don't see any. Do the ripples stop? Or do they just vibrate at a level that the eye doesn't pick up? Do they stop when you no longer see them, or do they stop when it hits the shore of the pond? Or does it ripple throughout the planet? Or does it ripple throughout the planet, ripple throughout the universe? In unified field quantum physics, they say that every time we come into a new understanding, a new consciousness, we learn something. It is owned and understood at the level of one proton, which then shares with every proton within us, which then shares with every proton within everyone else, which then shares within every proton of the universe. Our growth and understanding is what allows the universe itself to continue to grow and expand. And our right and our responsibility becomes pretty much one and the same. I have no idea any longer what your original question was, but I had a good time trying to answer.
No, that's very good. Well, I want to explore a little bit more about what you were saying. Your various patients were channeling. They were talking about that you were going to connect the strings. What exactly are the strings that they were referring to?
Well, let's back up, if we want to take those first four phrases, you're on three and four, maybe we should start with one and two. Is that all right?
Sure.
Okay. So when the researchers came to study what was happening in my office, before I even gave Reconnective Healing a name, because I didn't believe that it should have a name, to tell you the truth. I tried to keep it without a name, but everyone kept calling it Eric Pearl Healing or Pearl High Frequency Healing or all different names, and all including my name. And I knew we had to call it something so there'd be some consistency. The researchers came to look at it. And you see, I didn't want to call it anything, because when you give it a name, you place it within a box. You say, this is what it is, and everything outside the box is what it isn't. And I'll tell you, if you remind me, how I came up where the name we're leading into, Reconnective Healing, came from. But I knew we could reconnect with something that was ever expanding, and then our expansion and its expansion could continue. So I felt all right with giving it that name temporarily. Temporarily, I gave it that name. And here we are, probably 16 years later, with the temporary name. But anyway, the researchers came and started studying Reconnective Healing. And they said, we think you're bringing through aspects of light and information that we haven't seen here before. I said, really? What do you mean by that? And they said, well, we're seeing light and information, nonverbal information we've not witnessed. And I said, well, how can you make such a bold statement? And they said, it really makes sense if you understand two basic concepts. Concept A is we're four-dimensional beings. So we exist in this huge, vast, multidimensional universe. No beginning, no end. But we don't occupy the whole universe. We occupy four dimensions of it. So imagine this giant bubble or balloon floating around in the universe. All of humanity is inside of this bubble or balloon. The outside of the balloon, the part we're used to touching, would be comprised of height, width, depth, and time, and everything inside would be, as we've learned, energy. Everything's been energy. And in our energy healing techniques, we've been focusing in on portions of the energy, different portions, the Reiki, the portion, the Shikan portion, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Old techniques, new techniques. Technique focuses us in on subsets. What happens is that Reconnective Healing allows us to let go of subset and technique and access the entirety of the energy that's been within our four-dimensional existence. But that's only half of the answer. You see, outside of this balloon of energy has been aspects of light and information that haven't been here before, so they're timeless. They're not old, because they haven't existed within our bubble or balloon of time. They're timeless. When we release technique, we access the entirety of the energy within this bubble or balloon of height, width, depth, and time. We get a gift that's available to us today that hasn't been available to us before, because today, at a new level, time is moving faster. Time is not moving faster just from point A to point B. Time is moving faster in all directions at once, so time is actually expanding. Our bubble or balloon of time is expanding. As a balloon or bubble expands, it becomes more thin, more sheer, more permeable. Now, what's been inside of the balloon, the energy, is able to begin to interact with what's been outside of the balloon, the aspects of light and information. And as light and information comes inside of our four-dimensional existence, it's new for us, but it's not old, because it hasn't been here before, within time. You see, A, time is moving faster, which means B, time is expanding, our balloon is expanding, which means that C, what happens with the balloon is you blow it up, it gets thinner, more sheer, more permeable, so C, time is disappearing, which leads us to ultimately understanding what quantum physics teaches us today, is that time is an illusion. Reconnective Healing allows us to access our timeless truth of who and what we are, which is the reason they came to study this, because they at first thought the healings were fairly instantaneous, but they said they can't say they're instantaneous any longer, because an instant is a measurement of time, And these are happening outside of time. So it's the reason that reconnective healings seem to be virtually immediately. They're timeless. And because they happen outside of time, they're not affected by time, which is probably why once you've received reconnective healing, the healings usually tend to last for the person's lifetime. They don't need to come back again and again and again. It's all an interesting interplay, and I'm learning more from scientific insight and explanation, and I'm learning more from sharing and teaching it, because the more I talk about it, the more insight that I gain. I don't believe that science will ever fully understand this. I don't believe that any of us will understand it while we are here having our life experience. But I do believe that we are here to grow, and it's part of our purpose. One of the up-and-coming voices that I really enjoy today speaking in the field of quantum physics, unified field of quantum physics, is Nassim Haramein. And I remember he said, paraphrasing, of course, something along the lines of, as a child, he was asking himself, what is this experience that I'm having? And why isn't everyone else asking themselves the same questions? And one of the things that he explains today is that every experience and insight that we gain is owned by every proton in the universe. And this is part of how the universe continues on its expansion.
Very interesting. Now, can you give us a basis of understanding what exactly is illness or disease? What causes that?
What causes it? There are many different reasons. Many different reasons offered. And I don't claim to understand the mind of God. You could say, you know, there was a beautiful movie called Resurrection. It was not a religious movie, but it was very spiritual, with Ellen Burstyn. She was up for an Academy Award in it. I think it was 1980, Ellen Burstyn and Sam Shepard. And one of the characters, a character that I think played Ellen Burstyn's grandmother, said, some people need their illness to give love, some to get love. You know, we speak about going through our different health experiences for our lessons. But I think we should also take some time and start to maybe understand that it's also for the lessons of the people close to us, our friends, our family, people who take care of us. Maybe we're going through a health experience and we've all agreed upon this as a way for a mother or a child to learn a greater degree of compassion or understanding. We're all so interrelated. I mean, we have to understand that when one child cries in one part of the planet, 100 children weep somewhere else. When one child laughs, 1,000 children laugh. We are that connected. As a matter of fact, the channelings that started coming through Fred, after they stopped coming through everyone, I said they stopped coming through all my patients after about 3 months, they continued coming through Fred, and I would record them. I tape recorded them, and I had them transcribed on the paper, and Fred and I sat on them for about 20 years. And maybe just about 4 years ago or so, we released them in a book. The book is called Solomon Speaks. We named the voice Solomon. Let's not even go into why, but no, it doesn't mean it's King Solomon from the Bible. I just gave it a name. It's called Solomon Speaks on Reconnecting Your Life. And there's a lot of amazing insights and information in Solomon Speaks. Everything is dependent upon everything else, and we often tend to forget that. We often tend to not recognize that things are agreements. quite possibly. You know, maybe one parent dies young and you've had a close relationship with that parent. The other parent lives. For all we know, it's part of a mutual agreement to allow ourselves and that other parent to develop a deeper relationship, because you have to at that point, or you don't. That becomes a choice also.
I see.
Everything is dependent upon everything else. And what we do to others, we do to ourselves. What we do for others, we do for ourselves. I'm sorry, go ahead.
So along those lines, have you found that reconnective healing is effective 100% of the time in terms of healing a particular health, whether it's physical, spiritual, or psychological? Or are there some cases where it's not effective? And if that's true, then why do you believe that is? Does it go back to what you were just saying about some people need to have that illness in order to grow in a certain way?
I love that question, and I'll tell you why. We're not asking, I know our words are asking, what if it is, what if it isn't, when is it, when isn't it effective? Another way of saying it is, what if it works, what if it doesn't work, when does it not work? So why am I saying that's not the actual question we're asking? What is the actual question? The actual question that you're asking is, how often do I get the results that I, each of us, with our limited human, conscious, educated minds and perspectives, what if I do or don't get the results that I believe that I should get? We design a healing, and the first thing we do to limit it is to bring judgment into the equation. We immediately assess and determine what a good healing is and what a bad one is. Good and bad, judgment, right off. Patient comes in and they can't walk. We go, if they walk out of here, it's a good healing. If they don't walk, it's a bad healing. They come in and they can't move an arm. They can move it, it's good. They can, it's bad. They come and they have pain somewhere. The pain disappears, it's good. Pain doesn't disappear, it's bad. Really, I can tell you, with absolute personal certainty, I mean my certainty, is that reconnective healing works every time. Sometimes it comes in the form we anticipate. And sometimes, and we'll use that word fortunate again, if we're truly fortunate, it comes in a form we haven't even dreamed of, one that the universe has designed for us. And both as the recipient and as the reconnective healing practitioner, part of our own healing comes from our willingness to not judge the outcome on face value, but to step back 3 feet or 3 feet again, or 3 feet again, and look at what has occurred in context with the bigger picture to recognize the healing. For example, I'll take a story from the book, from the Reconnection. When I was here in Los Angeles still practicing in my office, a woman drove 3,000 miles from the East Coast to see me. She had terrible pain on one side of her face. She had it for 2 years. It was the result of Bell's palsy. Bell's palsy is when all the muscles of your face and half of your face just go kind of flaccid and they fall. And Bell's palsy is self-limiting, generally speaking. If you leave it alone, it goes away in 30 days. If you get some chiropractic adjustments, it usually goes away in the side of a few days to a week at most, generally. Well, the visual aspect, the part of her muscles that had fallen, had left, and her face looked normal. But she was left with a nerve pain on one side of her face that, for 2 years. so sensitive was she to this that if a door closed too openly or she passed by a fan or an open window, it would hurt her. She came out, told me all about the pain, had two sessions, and it didn't leave. So we could say, was reconnective healing? We could ask, was reconnective healing effective? And if we look only at the surface, if we look only at the base level of the word nora, we see fear. If we look only at the surface of the base level, we can say, well, her pain didn't go away. What she felt in her limited consciousness and perspective should happen, didn't happen. And what I bought into at that time, thinking it should happen, didn't happen. Now, finished her second session. She was leaving. She had her coat on, her bag in her hand. And on her way out the door, as an afterthought, she said to me, this was a woman who was broaching 50, you know, late 40s. She said to me, oh, by the way, when I was a young girl, 7, 8, 9 years old, I have a fever and an infection. I lost the hearing in one of my ears. I didn't tell you about it because that was who I am and I wasn't coming in for that. I can hear again. Did reconnective healing work? Absolutely. When we thought it didn't work, we were simply looking in the wrong places. We were simply too focused on too small a part of the picture. Now, that was nice. She shared that with me. Had she not shared that with me, I might have felt disappointment. Why would I have felt disappointment? Because that's your indicator. If you become a healing practitioner, when you feel disappointment that someone doesn't receive the healing you thought they had, that's your indicator that you are not only in judgment, but on one level or another, no matter how much you've spoken the words to the contrary, you are still accepting some level of credit deep inside you when you see what you consider to be a good or an effective healing. And the only way to know that is that when you don't see one, you feel sad or guilty or somehow responsible for something you're not responsible for. I had a woman come in on, she had a pain, a severe limp, a lot of pain, an older woman, a little crotchety in her nature, you know, and who knew, who could blame her, who knew how much pain she lived with every day. She came in, she had a healing session, she had scheduled 3 sessions. She didn't come back for her second session. Instead, I received a nasty letter, ugly, vitriol, toxic, the language I can't share with you. The emotion behind it was so ugly, I felt dirty from just holding the paper. I didn't know what to do with it. It was so mean. How could you do this? How could you take money? How could you be such a fake and a fraud and this and that? That I didn't want to put it in her file because I was embarrassed if an employee would find it. I didn't want to lose it in case anything came up and I needed it. Maybe there'd be something, maybe she'd take me to court. I didn't know. I took that paper. I pulled out a big file drawer. I put it in back where only papers might accidentally fall, so no one would intentionally look there, but I knew where it was. A month later or so, I'm talking to another person. And out of the blue, this woman appears. She knows the person I'm talking to. Oh, God, here she comes. She comes over to us with a smile on her face, laughing with her friend, talking, and her friend turns toward me and said, oh, yeah, I saw her after her session with you. She was in the supermarket. It was 2 days later. I said, where's your cane? She said, yeah, I don't need my cane anymore. She was so happy. Did she write me a letter to tell me? No. Did I feel like, you know what? Absolutely yes. You know why? My lesson. I was accepting responsibility or credit when the healing happened, so I felt guilty and responsible when it didn't. I felt that it was successful when we saw the results we were looking for, not successful when we didn't. And part of what we are here to learn, and part of Solomon's teachings, and Solomon speaks on reconnecting your life, part of the philosophy, the understanding of reconnective healing is that Your job as a healing facilitator is to open a door. It is the other person's job to have the courage to choose to walk through. But in the healing world, when we judge and take credit, we want them to walk through. We are so attached to them getting a specific result in mind that we open the door with our right hand, we take our left hands and we shove them through the door. And maybe it's not appropriate. Maybe it's not appropriate. Generally, it's not appropriate.
I've heard you talk about how reconnective healing is really the absence of technique and a lot of other, if not most other, more traditionally known healing techniques such as Reiki are very much immersed in technique. And many healers have this belief that they have to do a variety of things to protect themselves from the negative energy that the other person may give off or whatever in the healing process. Why do you feel that protection is not necessary? What's your concept of that? Anything you can share that might give some insight to people who are healers who have that perception?
Techniques are wonderful. We are here to evolve, and we're here to evolve out of requiring techniques. Techniques are like gorgeous training wheels on a bicycle. Training wheels are very valuable. They are. They help you or your child learn to develop his or her balance on the bicycle without injuring themselves. Did you learn the bicycle with training wheels? Yeah. So once you mastered the bicycle with training wheels, did your parents add a second or a third set of training wheels so you could be even better?
No, of course not.
What did they do?
Well, they took the wheels off and I rode without them.
Because you can master the bicycle with training wheels, but you'll never master the bicycle itself until the training wheels come off. The true gift of the training wheels comes only once you transcend or remove them. With our energy healing techniques, they're like training wheels. They teach us the beginning of balance in the energy healing world. But the true gift of the technique comes only once you transcend the technique. This technique gives you this part, the Reiki part. And this one gives you Jin Shin, and this gives you Jo Ray, and Alpha, Beta, Delta, Gamma, and Quantum this, and Mattress that, and all these different subsets and portions of energy. But once we release the techniques, we can access the entirety of the energy within this four-dimensional existence. And then, because time is expanding and disappearing, we can expand into light and information. Now, what happens when we access this whole field of energy and beyond, and then we add a technique? We reduce it back to only what that technique gives us. It's sort of like looking at the concept of wanting to understand God and love and the intelligence of the universe, and we might use a technique. Maybe the technique that we use could be a religion. So we spend our lives looking out of one of our windows of religion. I view religions as windows. So we have a window, same window our great-grandparents and our grandparents and our parents looked out of, and the one we want our kids to look out of, and one window shows a synagogue, and one shows a church, and one shows a mosque, and one shows a temple, and one shows a shrine, and then others show different shrines and temples and mosques and synagogues and churches, and we argue over whose window was right. Heaven forbid someone's window shows something different. It means one of us has to be wrong. It might as well be the other person, and some of us kill in the name of religion. But maybe we find a place within us, within our hearts, within our centering. Maybe we meet a person. We feel so beautifully in love with that person, we're willing to risk looking out of their window, and it does show something different. But we no longer view it as being a contradiction. We view it as being a compliment or an expansion. Maybe we become more curious and we look out of ultimately many other windows. But even if we look out of every window, we'll never see the whole picture because each window is limited by the window frame. And the view is further limited by the wall. The wall that supports the frame, that supports the window. Only once we're all willing to walk outside from behind those windows Maybe go up on the roof, join hands, have a party. Can we see 360 degrees in all directions? Who's the one person at that party on the roof who can't see 360 in all directions? The person who brings or adds their window frame. It reduces again. With reconnective healing, there is no technique, so we are able to access all of the energy and expand beyond it. What happened was, as I started doing reconnective healing, people started coming to me, healers, famous and not famous, from all around the world, offering suggestions and advice. They had heard about me in their dreams and their meditations and who knows what other places they told me they reasons they came. The first person would tell me, they'd say, you know, let me watch you do the healing. And they'd watch and they'd say, are you using protection, aren't you? And I thought, well, that's a little bit personal. What do you mean? They said, well, you have to use protection. I said, well, what should I protect myself from? Well, nothing really, but use protection. I said, is there something I should be afraid of? No, not really, but protect yourself. So I said, what should I do? They said, call in the presence of Mother, Father, God. So I called in the Mother, Father, God. The healing seemed to condense itself a little bit. So someone else came. They said, using protection. I said, of course, I'm bringing Mother, Father, God. They said, what about the archangels? Who knew? There's Michael, Gabriel, Uriel, Raphael. They all go to certain places. Excuse me, Mother, Father, God. Could you please move a little bit? I need an archangel over here. Someone else says, call in this entity. Someone else says, bring flowers in so the ghosts don't come. Someone else says, use these statues. Someone else says, say these prayers. The more things I'm doing, the less and less the healings are coming through. Until it finally dawned on me that every time we do something to make ourselves more, we're announcing to the universe that we're less than 100%. Every time we bring in a protection, we're telling the universe that there's something to be afraid of, so we're existing in a consciousness of fear. And as I let go of all the protections, all the rituals, all the techniques, the healings came back up. We are living in a world where it becomes our responsibility to understand that it's just not possible to give a gift that you're not willing or capable of accepting or receiving yourself. You cannot stand in fear of protecting yourself in a white flame, in a purple flame, in a gold flame. Then you feel really good until you find out that there's another flame that you've forgotten. And someone else says, bury the flame under the ground so the negative energy doesn't come up. And someone says, move your hands clockwise. Someone else says, counterclockwise. And then you get confused when you're in New Zealand and Australia, because now you have to go the other direction. And all of these protections and rituals and complicated techniques, we're worried about what if we do them wrong, we better do them right. What are we protecting ourselves from? They don't allow us to blossom as the flowers that we are. And when we let them go, we find out that fear, protecting ourselves in this and that and the other, doesn't allow us to facilitate healings at their highest level, because healings reside in love. You can't exist in lack and limitation, adding things to you, making yourself to be more, when consciousness of healing comes in abundance. We have to step out of the need of complex techniques and being in control when the consciousness of healing comes in freedom. And we're being challenged today to be more conscious and make these decisions. This is part of the reason that you can't mix energy healing techniques and rituals and protections with reconnective healing. You can't do them at the same time. You can't do them on every other day. You can't protect yourself on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and on Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday, understand there's nothing to protect yourself from. You can't stand in fear on Tuesday and Thursday, and Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Know that there's no negative energy to be afraid of, that if there's any negative energy on you, you don't need to shake it off and spray it off, but it's merely the beauty of the love, the healing process of God in the universe. Just like when you get out of bed from that one special person in your life that you've been embraced in all night snuggling, maybe it's a Sunday morning, and you want to let them sleep a little bit, so you quietly go downstairs, sit in the dining room, and do a little work on a project, and you reach across the table for something, you breathe in. and you catch that gorgeous scent of their skin still on yours, and you re-experience the love you've been embraced in all night long. Tell me, do you really feel like reaching for a bottle of alcohol to spray it off? I mean, either we understand that healing and the residue and all the effects of it is God love and the intelligence of the universe, or we think it's something evil and fear-based. Either we realize that it's our essence and its highest level of orchestration is that by the intelligence of the universe, or we think we'd be in charge and control because we know more than God, love, and the intelligence of the universe. And we can't know our truth half the time. We can't know it on Tuesdays and Thursdays and not on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday.
I know you've done some experiments using reconnective healing in genetic experiments on humans and animals and plants. Can you tell me about some of the results of those experiments?
You may be speaking about DNA a little
yes.
bit.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, to understand this, we have to understand a few things. We have to understand that our bodies don't heal the way we were taught. The way I learned when I was in school. Medical schools were teaching, and I don't know if some of them still might be. What we know through quantum physics is pretty much obsolete. They were teaching the biochemical model. They were teaching that something happens to you. Biochemicals are produced. You know, a message goes to the brain sends a message, the brain produces biochemicals, biochemicals travel. And we know today that healing doesn't work that way. It works through what's called the light model. Biochemical model couldn't explain if something had happened in one part of the body and immediately affect another part of the body. The light wave being simultaneously everywhere can explain that. Our brains don't work the way we were taught. We were taught there were little compartments in our brain, one for speech, one for memory, one for language, one for this, one for that. And we now know that the information throughout our brains is diffused throughout our brains, and it's not even in our brains, but our brains receive them. Our brains are transducers for information from a field that science today refers to as zero-point field, much like a computer is a transducer for information from the internet field. Now, the light model. It used to be considered just spiritual and metaphysical to talk about us as human beings as being light. We now know from the work of Dr. Fritz Albert Popp in Germany and others, substantiating, corroborating, and continuing his work, that the DNA in each of our cells emits levels of light. That humans have specific levels of light that are different than cows and goats and donkeys and goldfish. It is generally considered that when our light is dimming, our health is diminishing. When our light is coming back up, our health is coming back up. Studies, and there have been approximately six, I believe, two with plant DNA, two with animal DNA, and two with human DNA, have shown that reconnective healing actually restructures. It's funny, when I first wrote the book, I didn't want to talk about the DNA, but I had to because there was this big gaping hole in the book without sharing the story of the DNA. There wasn't any science yet. Now there is. Studies have shown that the reconnective healing frequencies restructure, or as I like to say, reconnect our DNA in such a way that it not only seems to raise the level of light that we emit, but makes it more coherent, as they say, which translates to more harmonic. So now we have a more coherent, harmonic communication of the healing light system communication system in our bodies. What is it when we fall away from perfect health? Is that we're really falling away from a state of harmony. We enter into disharmony. And we bring back coherent, harmonic light in our healing system. We return to that state of harmony once again.
When you're talking about that, are you referring to three-dimensional DNA? Or are we talking about multidimensional DNA, for example? Nowadays, especially in a lot of spiritual circles, there's a lot of talk about 12-strand DNA and how the human human beings are evolving to a 12-strand DNA. So can you offer a little bit more clarity into that?
There is a 12-stranded DNA system. I know this from a story I won't go into. It's in the book. It's too long to tell right now. When I'm talking about the studies on the DNA, they were focusing on the two strands. DNA is a very funny thing, though. 98% of the DNA that science can find, let's not even go into multidimensional DNA. Science doesn't know what it's for. Do you know what they call it?
Junk DNA, of course.
Junk DNA, of course. Why is it called junk DNA? Because they don't know what it is. And heaven forbid, they don't know something. So they give it a name that is somewhere from misleading to just plain wrong. It's not the first time that science does that. Science says that the space between protons and neutrons and electrons is empty. Well, it's not. It's an informational field. If it weren't an informational field, things couldn't function. Everything exists before science discovers it. It doesn't not exist because science hasn't proven it. Everything has to exist before science discovers it, otherwise science would have nothing to discover. So we tend to confuse absence of proof with proof of absence. When we don't know something, science and medicine often mislabels it. Do you have your tonsils or have they been removed?
I have them.
You have them. You know a lot of people, they've been removed on, right?
Mm-hmm.
So back in the 50s and 60s and maybe even the 70s, science and medicine thought that tonsils were something vestigial, left over from prehistoric times, served no purpose. So when the tonsils became inflamed, they considered the tonsils a threat to the person's health. If they became inflamed multiple times, they went in and surgically removed them. Now, it didn't take long until they figured out that the tonsils were the body's first line of defense, at least against certain airborne diseases. So what they were doing by removing the tonsils were, it's like a country that's being attacked and you go in and remove your own army. That's a little foolish, isn't it? So when the tonsils are inflamed multiple times, they're not causing the problem. They're telling you that something is out of balance within your body. And your tonsils are your first indicator of that. So look within the body to restore it to balance. How can you do that? Chiropractic is a beautiful way. People who experience chiropractic oftentimes simply stop getting tonsillitis because the tonsils function better. Same thing I would say from my experience with reconnective healing in other people. Once you have reconnective healing, it's not that it heals tonsils. It brings the body back into a state of optimal balance. So the tonsils are in better condition and shape to do their job. But we removed the tonsils. Now later on, we found out that the tonsils, I heard in a medical symposium, are responsible for producing beta cells that protect us from cancer. And when I share this at a training program or a seminar or a lecture, the whole audience takes in a breath, you know. But I tell them to relax. They don't have to worry because there is one other organ that produces those beta cells, I learned. Appendix. The other organ that they removed, you know. While we're in there, we might as well remove the appendix. So, when we don't know the answer, it would be nice to say we don't know yet instead of assigning the tonsils and the appendix and the ununderstood DNA to the category of junk and useless. And with that understanding, something tells the molecules in my mobile phone to keep this shape, and something tells the molecules in this piece of paper to flow like this, And what that is a field that is not empty at all. It's a field of information. And when we understand that, then we understand that this informational field is interacting with this informational field. And then we start to understand through unified field quantum physics that nothing is really ever touching. And therefore everything is touching. And that no matter how we try to separate ourselves from another person or choose to physically intertwine with them, no one is touching and everyone is touching. And in order to access truly the highest level of healing and consciousness, we have to start to then recognize that no one is special. And therefore, everyone is special.
Now, with we were talking early on in our conversation about how our cells are replaced every so often, and so essentially every year we have a whole new body. But every time the cell reproduces in your average human being, at different paces, the cells are actually aging, right? So the telomeres are getting shorter, and so each subsequent series of cells is actually slightly older than the previous, except in some cases, and there are some Chinese herbs and whatnot that apparently can slow that process or even reverse it. And even in the U.S. in recent years, there have been some new supplements that clinically have shown the ability to reverse that process.
Sort of, and to a degree.
Yes.
In other words, the process of aging can be slowed. And if you've experienced advanced aging, that might be able to be somewhat reversed. But let's not view aging and even transitioning this physical lifetime for the next with something being wrong.
But what governs...
Go ahead.
No, you go. Well, the question that I had was, with reconnective healing, obviously it's restoring the body into balance. So what's obviously, even with the body in balance, two people with both their bodies in balance are going to live to different ages. So what governs that difference in age? Why would everybody not live to the same age? And ultimately my question is, does reconnective healing or this connection to this balanced state prolong life in some way?
I would consider it an optimization of life. Where I was going when I was speaking before, what I was going to lead into is that according to science, once again, which doesn't mean it's absolutely correct, you know, what we knew 100 years ago, we found out 50 years ago was wrong, and some of what we found out was wrong 50 years ago, 25 years later, we found out was right again. So, but you know, it's what we consider facts are really not ever truly facts. They're generally agreed upon consensus of opinion. But all that aside, science tends to stand behind the concept that the body is designed to live for approximately 120 years. Now, there are some people who say that healing should mean that you live forever, but they don't really understand that there is a grand plan if they think that. There are old souls and new souls, and how do we learn through different experiences if we stay in this one lifetime in this one human body for the next 25,000 years? I mean, maybe we are here to cycle through, and I believe that's what we're designed to do. But we're not designed necessarily to only partially or weakly live or experience our lives, but maybe we're designed to optimally and with strength live our lives as fully as possible at as high a level as possible, and maybe towards the end as we get close to that time span, you know, quickly let it peter out and go on to the next level of our journeys. Now, Where do you live?
Me, I live, well, near Detroit, Michigan, but yeah.
Okay, so you live near Detroit. Air pollution?
It's not as bad as out there, I'm sure.
Well, I was going to get into that, but you've got air pollution there, you've got buses, you've got exhaust. We have it in most every major city. Yes, we've got smog in LA, it's even worse. We have people who live in one part of the world that has that. We've got people who live out in clean air. We've got people who eat certain diets and not other diets. We have people who have different stressors emotionally or physically. Look, maybe we're three people that are designed to live for 120 years, but one of them has a piano land on them and they die. Okay, and that's an extreme, but I'm saying we have stressors at various different levels. We have genetic susceptibilities we're built with. We have allergies and sensitivities and other responses that we develop with years or lose with years. Different genders. We come from different parts of the world. Some of our skins are more or less sensitive to light. Some of our body types are more or less sensitive to certain foods or certain spices or certain chemicals. Some of us just have a different nature or personality because of the chemical balance with which we're given. So we are not inert glass test tubes. We're not science in a laboratory living under the same exact control conditions. We will have various responses and results, but we can optimize our responses and results. For example, genetically, we know that certain women inherit a trait where there's a higher likelihood they may develop breast cancer than others. Medicine, of course, you know, in some areas is actually pushing for breast removal as a way to preempt it. We're different. And I think we're here to discover and in many cases celebrate our differences and bring ourselves to our optimal levels of interactive harmony, be it interactive within us and interactive within everyone else. I believe that understanding that our growth affects every proton within us and every proton within the universe, as we grasp that growth, that evolution, that insight, that understanding, I believe that even just working one-on-one, sharing reconnective healing, one person at a time, that we become a part of world harmony today. World harmony, both as a macrocosm and a microcosm.
Now, do you think that you mentioned a few factors that affect our health and longevity and can change the kind of environments we're influenced by? And do you think that diet makes a big difference in terms of health? I ask that because I know that you have a very different, you're not a vegetarian even, are you?
I eat my vegetables in a very compact form called cows.
Exactly. So does it matter?
Go ahead.
Well, the question I have is, I know that your diet wouldn't necessarily be what a lot of people consider conventionally healthy, but obviously you find it to be beneficial for you. So,
well, actually, my diet, you see, there are many different diets. My diet is certainly considered more healthy by many people than someone who eats a vegetarian diet. Now, people who are health-oriented, many of them eat a vegetarian diet. or who consider themselves health oriented, but yet more people eat a diet with meat, fish, or chicken. So it's not a question of more or less. You know, two nutritionists, three opinions. If you go back in time, humanity evolved from, I believe it was Australopithecus Africanus. There was a vegetarian Australopithecus and a meat eater. And historically, the vegetarians spent most of their time foraging for food and they died off, and we evolved from the meat eaters. There are two schools of determining diet. There's comparative anatomy and comparative dentistry. Now, I don't want to tell you what to eat and what not to eat, but I will tell you, according to comparative dentistry, which takes all the different types of our teeth, the molars and incisors and wisdom and this, that, and the canines, does a percentage on them. Humans are considered to be designed to have a 2/3 carnivorous diet. Comparative anatomy, that takes the length of the spinal cord or the spinal column and compares it with the intestines, also comes up with a 66% carnivorous diet. Now, there are vegetarian studies designed by vegetarians which will tell you something different, but often their interpretation is a bit skewed. I'm still not here to tell you what to and what not to eat. My partner is a vegetarian, and she has been all of life. And we spend a lot of times where we only juice or eat raw vegetables. But when I'm ready for a steak, I'm ready for a steak. And if I want a pizza, I want pepperoni or anchovy on there. I believe that we are here to experience the colors, the flavors, the designs of life, and to eat according to wisdom. If certain foods upset you, they upset you. If not, not. But I don't think we're here to follow a rigid path. I believe in a low-carbohydrate diet. I do. For others, they don't. There are books out that will say, eat this if your blood type is this, and eat that if your blood type is that. I really think that they're selling you a book more than actually understanding who you are, because I'm sorry, everyone with type O blood does not belong on the same diet. But these are personal decisions. I don't believe that they should be made for you. Instead, they should be made by you. And change. Listen, if I ask an audience, how many of you remember the first time you've given up meat? A lot of hands go up. And then they laugh because they realize I asked them the first time they gave up meat, because their body started to crave it. And there are many studies, and this is a complex question that sounds simple. Eat what you want. You know, for me, I have a wonderful time going home, watching a movie, making truffle popcorn, or experiencing a gorgeous vanilla ice cream. Eat what you want.
Tell me about some of the more dramatic or profound healing results that you, and I know getting attached to results is not the direction we want to go, but I am curious, just for the sake of, to demonstrate and inspire people as to what's even possible or what can even happen as we connect to this higher dimensional awareness, one aspect of which is reconnective healing. What are some of the results that you have found?
I know in the beginning of the program, I shared with you some of the original concepts of the healings that came about that awakened me more to what was going on here. If I say that this person with disease A had this healing, then people start to think reconnective healing works for this. If this person had a low libido, many people after they experience reconnective healing say, my sex life got better, my libido improved, and therefore, and I don't know what happened to my girlfriend or my boyfriend, but they started treating me better you know, as well. And it's all part of a bigger picture. Reconnective healing is not about what we healed from. Reconnective healing is about life progress. It's about evolving on our paths and returning to a state of balance and harmony. And to reduce it to this improved, that improved, makes people say reconnective healing is good for this problem and good for that problem. And the truth is, when people say to me, does reconnective healing help with this problem or does it fix or heal that problem? I say, no, it doesn't. It doesn't address anything. They say, yeah, but I know this person who had severe acne and it went away. And I know this person who had a hole in the bottom of their foot the size of a pencil eraser, and they woke up the next morning after the reconnective healing and it was gone. And someone else who had eczema for all of his life, and so did his uncles and his cousins and everyone on his father's side of the family, and after his first reconnective healing session the eczema was gone. And do these things happen? Yes, but I don't want you to think that reconnective healing is a treatment for eczema or a cure for psoriasis. Reconnective healing is not a treatment. It is not therapy. Otherwise, it would be called reconnective treatment or reconnective therapy. Treatment and therapy is about symptom and diagnosis. And reconnective healing, we pay no attention to what the diagnosis of the symptoms are. The practitioner, as you will learn, simply, as we discussed, opens a door. And the person coming to receive reconnective healing simply chooses to walk through that door, and they come back with the gift that is most appropriate for them. So I really don't focus on these things. Reconnective healing is not a cure for anything. As a matter of fact, medicine thinks they own the word cure, so I wouldn't use it anyhow.
What are you finding is happening on a global scale in terms of the awakening of consciousness right now? I know we touched a little bit about on the 12-strand DNA and whatnot, but obviously, the time of reconnective healing being present in our linear time at this moment is significant. And I'm finding there are many significant things happening in terms of healing modalities, but just people just awakening to a new version of reality. And in our modern spiritual vernacular, we're referring to it as fifth dimension. And so what else are you noticing in the world, and do you really see that we are heading toward a world where more and more of this connection to a higher dimensional awareness is happening?
You know, I want to talk about some of these things, and I will, you know, when we're at the Awaken Empowered Expo, we're going to talk about that. I'm doing, a 2-hour keynote presentation on Saturday afternoon or evening, and there'll be a panel that I'm on or two on that Sunday. And these things will come up, but they're very good questions and they're interesting questions, including your phrasing of them. Yes, we are evolving more. We're becoming more multidimensional, more aware, more real. We're not reaching for externals and techniques. We're not looking for, the world doesn't need another energy healing technique, and I'm not here to teach one. What we need to do is learn how to remove those training wheels of technique. And we are becoming more timeless beings. We're moving beyond fourth dimension, but we're not becoming fifth dimensional. Now, why do I say that? Because our four-dimensional existence of height, width, depth, and time is our linear existence here on Earth. And this is not easy to explain because our language is linear and our examples and our perspectives are linear. And we're looking now to understand and explain and talk about, move into a non-linear consciousness with linear language and perspective. Why is there no such thing as a fifth dimension? Because once we step beyond four-dimensional, everything is non-linear, simultaneous. We become no longer limited to our physical local beings. We become non-local beings, timeless in a state of existence. So when we are linear, 1, 2, 3, 4, If we go into fifth dimensional, we're still stuck in linear. Since we don't have a nonlinear language, we've come up with a mutually agreed upon term for what goes on beyond four dimensional. It's referred to as multidimensional. Now, semantically, you could argue that 4, 3, and 2 are also multidimensional, and they are. It's just that we're at a loss for word. So after four dimensional, we become multidimensional. There's no longer past, present, and future. Everything is simultaneous. There are no more past lives. There are simultaneous lives. There's no more deja vu. It's all simul-vu. And so that's why I said, what comes next after multidimensional? Nothing comes next. Multidimensional continues to expand.
Okay, very interesting. And well, a lot of people who may be watching this show, I'm sure not as many as mainstream people who wouldn't be watching a show like this, for example, but a lot of mainstream, what's that?
Why not?
I'm sure they will be as time goes on.
Well, but, no, really, I'm telling you, do you know that the more spiritual energy healer background type of person was who first started coming when I was teaching Reconnective Healing, you know, and it was mostly women and mostly people with those backgrounds. Today, the audience is pretty much 40-60 women to men, and very many people come from mainstream society. Yes, there are a lot of doctors and nurses and physical therapists and others in that field and acupuncturists. And yes, there are massage therapists. And yes, there are many energy healers. And the energy healers, especially the masters, are coming to transcend the limitation, the glass ceiling of technique. And the people who come from mainstream medical health are coming because they know that there's more than mainstream medical health care is bringing them. But the other half of the people who come are university students and organization CEOs. They're truck drivers and taxi drivers, and they run banks and they're government officials. They come because they're clergy in various religions, and they come because they come from a background of they're agnostic or atheist. I mean, it's the whole span. And they come and attend from the age of children to into their 90s and some above.
Well, you essentially answered my question, which was, are you seeing that the mainstream, the global population of the mainstream mindset is really moving toward this fourth dimensional? Are you seeing tangible evidence of that movement happening?
Reconnective healing always seemed to attract more of the mainstream, more of the balance male, female, more of the balance of overall society. I think for two reasons. I think the reason that people might jump at it first is because it attracted so much scientific interest and still does. I think the other reason is that it vibrates at a level of truth that subconsciously, subliminally, we recognize. I mean, the truth is, why do birds fly north or fly south? Do they sit down logically and say, at Thursday's meeting, we were told, pack your bags? Or does something inside just know, now it's time? I think that's what's happening with Reconnective Healing. Now it's time. It's time for evolution. It's time for life progress. And we can have it.
Well, thank you for joining me today. Would you like to share some links to your website and anywhere else where people can find out about the events you're doing and your books for sale and anything else?
Well, of course, you know, there's Twitter and Facebook and Instagram and all of those fun things. But really, the website, it's one website. It's just like the main book is called The Reconnection, Heal Others, Heal Yourself, which, by the way, It's an international bestseller going now into its 40th language. The website is also called thereconnection.com. You have to use the word the. So it's thereconnection.com. You can find out where we are, where we will be. You can find a directory of practitioners. You can find a link. You can find a link to this interview, quite possibly, I think. You can find pretty much everything at thereconnection.com.
And what will you be covering during your two-hour lecture at the expo?
Well, we've touched on a lot of things, and I will go into more depth on some of them and touch on some others. I think it's time for us to begin to recognize and step into our non-local, timeless existence. Normally, what I'll do at the expo is I'll talk about the history, the theory, the science, the philosophy. We'll bring up some volunteers from the audience, possibly with maybe long-term medically documented physical limitations, such as maybe an arm that won't move or a hand that won't close or something, so we can give some live demonstrations of the healings. And depending on how we're set up, we might even begin to teach you how to start to feel it and work with it in your hands. I'm not sure what the setup is there yet. And I like to go with the flavor of the audience. So there'll be question and answer, hopefully. And I want to be able to talk about what you want to hear on that day.
Fantastic. Sounds very interesting. Well, I'm looking forward to meeting you in person very soon. And thank you for taking time out of your schedule to be on our show today.
Thank you. It's been absolutely my pleasure.
I hope you enjoyed this episode of Awaken and Power TV with my special guest, Dr. Eric Pearl. Join me next week as we speak with another incredible individual who's standing on the leading edge and changing the world.